Hi there, welcome to this learning series on Amazon Web Services or AWS or simply Amazon Cloud. We are going to learn all the AWS services and products and would also learn how we can deploy and develop a vast range of applications that includes IoT application, web application, Android application or simply a storage device or data warehousing or complex ERP solutions. We can build a vast range of applications and we will learn here with practical demonstration and would create sample projects in each category. We will learn about each of the services or products one by one in depth. So let's start. So these are some of the vendors. Most popular vendors, the General Electronics, Expedia, TCL, Ubisoft, Vodafone, Adobe, Samsung. These involve or employ the use of Amazon Web Services and rely on AWS Cloud. So AWS has evolved over a rapid pace of innovation from year 2006 or 6, 7, 8. With a simple 24 applications or Amazon Elastic Cloud Compute or EC2 or with Elastic Block Storage, and now it has evolved to a huge range of services and products in multiple categories like compute, database, analytics, IoT. Even it has a game engine. It has an AR and VR support, augmented reality and virtual reality support for innovation and development. There are various competitors in the market for AWS that includes IBM's Bluemix, Microsoft Azure, and Google Cloud. But AWS is ranked first among all those cloud vendors. In various terms, in terms of market capture, AWS has over 34% of the cloud share. It is simple to simple developers or basic developers, or it is very vast for complex or advanced developers. It has a very interactive environment and simple to deploy your applications. So these are the services. These are various services that we can use to empower our application and create a huge range of applications. It has analytics, mobile development, app development, enterprise app, hybrid cloud management, management tools. It has a marketplace where we can develop and sell our code even to our fellow developers or any other developers. We can work in a team and host a DevOps process toolchain. Here we get a technical support from AWS, as well as AWS also provides us learning content, and AWS certification is most prestigious IT certification to do. Almost everyone is seeking an AWS certification if he is related to he or she related to cloud computing. It is a very reliable and ever-growing platform. AWS has infrastructure services and it has very secured environment. So why we need a cloud? Actually, cloud is used to scale our project. You might have an idea what a cloud computing is. If you have to develop an entire infrastructure, either you host a website or a complex ERP solution. If you have to store them on a physical bare metal server in your data center right in your office, you need some staff workers to manage them, and a huge amount of salary and electricity bills and networking bills has to be paid to them. And if your data has to be scaled up, you need more racks and racks in your data center. It would be hard to every time control that thing. For getting rid of those things, we shifted to cloud. Amazon hosts all the infrastructure, networking, and other parts, and we have to deploy our application and get involved to each of the services. As you can see here, these are the few services of Amazon Web Services. These are the facilities and tools that we can use from all the categories: compute, storage, content delivery, database networking, developer tools, management tool, analytics, mobile services like Cognito, which is very popular these days, enterprise applications and other applications. We can employ them, and we need as a developer or cloud architect or developer, we have to grasp all the key terms involved here, and which we are going to do, and learn each of them one by one in a better and slow and steady pace. And we are going to master these things at the end of the course. We will cover all the theoretical part and build a practical solution. So this image was of a dashboard, AWS services dashboard, that was previously available, but now it looks like this. A range of product has increased. As you can see in earlier image, there are only four services in the compute category: EC2, EC2 container services, Elastic Beanstalk, and Lambda. But now it has six services: EC2, Lightsail, which is a new service, Elastic Container Service, Lambda, and Batch, which is a new service, and other services. Similarly, there has increased services in each category, either be machine learning, analytics, or other things. Database and storage services be the same. In analytics, we get a new service that is QuickSight, Athena. We have AWS DeepLens, the Pinpoint, and other services. So we will learn each of them later. So thanks for now. Welcome friends. So now we are going to create our own AWS account, Amazon Web Services account, which is vital for exploring all the AWS services and deploying anything using AWS. So just search on Google or any search engine, the AWS free tier account, or simply go to aws.amazon.com/free. Now on the top right, just hit the create an AWS account button. Here you will be redirected to a link where you can create an account. Just simply provide all the informations required. First, there appears an email ID. Just provide an email ID. Create a check that I am a new user. Then hit the sign up button. Enter your name. If you are an individual, you can create an individual account. If you are a company or an organization, you can create your organization's account. It is very simple. Just re-enter your email ID, your credentials, your password, and retype the password again. Then hit the create button, create account. Then your contact information is required, your address, your country. I'm just providing some garbage value, anything, because I've already created an account. So this is an example for a company or organization. You can select from any country. Example, India. You Just provide the address information and other informations. Address, city, state, postal code, phone number, and other informations right here. For example, anything. Enter the captcha and now just provide your payment information, the debit card number or credit card number, name on your card. It is very important step. Actually, you are not charged any amount until you select any services that are not in covered in your free account. Just provide all the informations and click the verify button. Then there will be OTP, one-time password requirement for your related to your connected with your mobile phone number with your bank account. When it is verified, a token amount is debited from your account. For example, 2 rupees or 4 cent or any such amount. It will be returned back by the Amazon later on. Then enter the OTP. When it is verified, you can move to further steps. Identity verification. Here you need to provide your phone number, a mobile number, along with the country code and AWS. There you will receive a call from AWS and you need to enter the PIN which is provided to you. After completing this step, you can move further. It may take some time for verification, but not much time. When your identification is completed, you can move to your dashboard. You can select whether you are a basic developer or a student or business, anything. Just select from them. I'm just selecting basic, then click continue. So this is your account created and you can move to dashboard. Sign into your account, enter your username and password. The username is typically your email ID and password, and then you can access your dashboard and all the AWS services thereby. So this is a home page. These are all the services. And this is your account. Hope this works. If you find any error, you can call them. So friends, we have learned about AWS dashboard and its interface, various services. And now we are going to learn about AWS command line interface. The command line interface for Amazon Web Services is very useful when you would like to run remote commands for your scaling of projects. When you have less number of projects, less files with you,
You can directly configure or upload or perform various operations directly from the dashboard. But when number of resources and files increase drastically to hundreds or thousands, you may need to manage simply using CLI, command line interface, that works remotely from your personal computer, PC. You can automate various processes using various commands. So here we are going to learn how we can install AWS CLI and work remotely. The steps involved for this process is we need to first install AWS CLI. Then we need to create user in Amazon Identity and Access Management. Then we need to configure AWS CLI using credentials for IAM. So let's go to first step, download and install AWS CLI. Move to your search engine. Just type download AWS CLI. The first or second link, move to first or second link. Here we can download AWS CLI for Windows 64-bit or 32-bit or for Mac and Linux. But for Mac and Linux, we need Python and pip to be pre-installed. They installed these two tools and then you can install AWS CLI. So I'm a Windows user and my computer is 64-bit, so I would like to click here. As I have already downloaded and installed this, I would not go with it. You could download it, and it is a simple process, not very difficult. When it is installed, just hit the next button and agree. It will be installed very simply. Just move to command prompt or terminal in Linux and just simply type AWS. When it is installed, things may look like this. AWS help and other commands that can be run here. So this was simple. There is no separate command line interface for AWS. It gets embedded on your operating system's command line utility or Linux shell. It is simple. Next, we will learn to create IAM users and configure the credentials. Let's log into your AWS account and move to the dashboard. We have logged in, move to the service panel, and from service, move to security, identity, and compliance category and hit the IAM button. Here we can create, this is a dashboard for identity and access management. Here we can manage everything. Just move to users on the left hand side of your dashboard. We need to hit the add user button and create a new user. Just provide a name for the user, for example, hs-aws. Could be better for me. Provide access type programmatic access, as we need to work on various API, CLI, and SDK. Just create a group. We need to create a group and provide the permission for your resource. For example, if you are creating this account for Lambda, you could provide the permission for Lambda. Just write Lambda and select the particular role that you would need for this thing. You can also select multiple options. I would select AWS Lambda Full Access for right now and provide a group name. If you don't provide, it will show error. Just provide a name. I will provide a similar name as the user. You can provide anything. Create the group. The group is being created. It is here. You can see attach policy and full details. by moving to this link. So this is the permissions, the Amazon resource name, ARN, and other services for various AWS services like cloud formation and other thing. You can see here, attached entities, policy versions, access advisors, and other things. Next, we need to, you can copy permissions from here and change, but I don't need to do this right here. Move towards downwards of the page and hit the next button, review. Hit the create user button. The user will be created. So this is the user, this is the access key ID and secret access key. We would need these things. You need to keep this secret. For configuration, it is important. I will later delete this thing so you could not use it. Just move to your command line interface and write the AWS command to check whether it is working or not. It is working. Let me do some adjustment. Just type AWS config for configuration. So this may show various options for which you can use for config. But for configuration, we need to type configuration, not config. So I did a mistake. You can move above and read various statements that are printed. Now we need to type AWS space configuration, configure, sorry, AWS configure. It would ask you access key ID. This is the access key ID. Copy it from here. Enter. Provide the secret access key. It is unique per IAM user. Choose the default region. As I have no region selected, you can check it from your dashboard right here. Just move to above on the taskbar. And here you can see global. IAM does not require any region to be selected. So just type none, N-O-N-E. Then it is okay. Your AWS command line is configured. If you want to reconfigure it, you can configure it later. As friends, we have learned about AWS command line interface. In the previous video, we have installed AWS command line interface and configured using identity and access management from AWS services. And here we are diving deeper into AWS command reference, all the available commands for Amazon command line interface for every services. So just type on Google AWS CLI command reference or any other thing. So this is the document page that opens up. Move to table of content, and here you can see all the services of Amazon Cloud displayed in blue color, be it API Gateway, Athena, Auto Scaling, Cloud9, CloudFront, CloudSearch, CloudTrail, CloudWatch. Just open it in new tab or in the same tab. You will get the full reference for each service commands. Command reference for each service. DynamoDB, Elastic Beanstalk, Events, Firehose, Glacier, Glue, Greengrass, and various services. Because AWS has a huge range of services, and it is difficult to remember all the commands for each services. So it is always being updated, and we don't need to remember anything. just move to documentation, and here you get. So these are the commands for CloudWatch. Delete alarm, describe alarm. We can select any command and read the synopsis, how it is written. So the anything which is not enclosed in a square bracket is compulsory, and rest all the fields that are enclosed in a square bracket are optional. You could either provide the optional fields or do not provide the optional fields. This is the list for commands for AWS Lambda for serverless computing. We can add permission, create alias, create event source mapping, create function, delete alias, delete function, and perform various operations remotely. If we have a huge range of Lambda services, we would prefer the command line interface over the normal GUI mode. So this is the syntax for creating a function using AWS Lambda on command line interface. So this is a mandatory field to provide function name, and within values, we need to provide the name of the function that we are defining. A runtime, we have to provide runtime for the language interface, for example, Node 4.3. Role, the IAM role, the handler function that is the main function for Lambda, and all the fields are optional. You can read all the documentation and betterly understand what each category or refers to. Just moving into detail how it is written completely. So this is the page. Here, the first thing we need to write the AWS command, that is the first command. Then we need to write the name of the service that we are using. For example, here we are using Lambda service. So we need to write Lambda. If we are using CloudWatch or Mobile Hub or any other service, we need to write the service name. Then the action, the particular command, for example, create function, then we need to provide function name, runtime, role, handler, timeout, zip file, and region. As Lambda services are basically regionless, so we can, if you want to leave this part, you just do not write that thing. We could type it on command line interface using the very own CLI mode of the operating system, like Windows command prompt or Linux shell. Just type the AWS command to check whether it is working or not. We have done this in the previous video. We have configured using IAM role. So it is working. AWS command is being accepted. And then we can write this AWS Lambda create function action. So it must ask us to provide the configuration files, because I have deleted that configuration file earlier. Yeah, so it may ask you to provide a configuration. So we can configure using AWS configure as earlier video, and then we can write anything here. You could save those files using zip or upload on S3 bucket.
Hi there, welcome to this learning series of AWS certification. Here we would explore different learning paths for cloud practitioner, cloud architect, developer, operational engineer, and more. We would also cover the skill sets required for each certifications and create instances by learning in depth of various services available on Amazon Cloud. At the end, we would test our skills with a practice test prepared in the format of AWS certification. So without wasting any time, let's start with AWS. Here, the AWS certification is very prestigious, which demonstrates the technical expertise of a person to advance your career. And it also helps employees to employ the certain skilled professionals for various kind of jobs. It is beneficial for both individuals as well as companies or corporates, those who employ such individuals. For individuals, they can practice their skills for deploying, designing, and operating high available cost effective
and secure applications on Amazon Web Services or AWS Cloud. It helps individuals to gain a recognition and visibility of your proven skills with or without projects and proficiency on AWS. It also helps you gain credibility over employers and your competitors or peers. You can also earn different kinds of tangible and non-tangible benefits, such as you would, after gaining your certification, you could also enhance your academic qualification, expertise over different set of tools, and it will help you gain promotions and even a new kind of jobs in the industry. For employers, it will help them identify various skilled persons, and they don't need to perform a hard training for such individual of the cloud, and as well as a recruitment process would be simple for such individuals. They could already test their skills on the basic level, and they could guarantee whether a person is mature enough to take the risk of implementing cloud and different solutions. It will also help them increase the customer satisfaction, because by hiring a professional skilled person, they could guarantee the upcoming of their services and utilities on the web. When we are trying to pursue the AWS certification and we are a beginner for AWS certification, we would first need to understand what are different kinds of certifications offered by Amazon. It is officially offered by Amazon, not any third party thing. Already there are various kind of certifications out there, but they are not recognized by the industry. Only few of them is recognized, and the best to do, go with the Amazon certification. The official Amazon certifications comes in various levels and formats. It consists of professional, associate, and foundational level certifications, which could be obtained by taking the examinations and obtaining the minimum qualified marks. Say for cloud practitioner, you have to obtain a 70% marks for qualification. And for different levels, they have different criteria that could change over time. And you can also have a specialty certification in different fields and role-based certifications. And the cloud practitioner would be the foundation for all kinds of certifications. If you are a beginner, you have to pursue this cloud practitioner certification, which will help an industry recognize you that you are familiar to different set of services and tools that are available on AWS Cloud at the beginner level. After you are qualified practitioner, you could apply for different learning paths. Here we have a path for architect, for DevOps, developer operations, and for system operations. And then we have a networking, a big data, and security. If you're trying for solutions architect, that could build a solution on Amazon Cloud to deploy enterprise level applications and different sort of things, you have to go with the associate level after you have done with cloud practitioner. And after you are done to associate level, you could apply for professional level. It will help you increase your skills level, and also it will help you benefit in gaining a designation or more package options on the jobs. Similarly, you could have a for developer profile, the developers who could deploy various applications on the cloud, who understand the fundamentals of containerization, virtual machines like Docker and more things out there, and could build a useful solution. Then we have sysop managers that could operate various overflow of the testing and different set of things. You would be familiar with Cloud9, code commit, code deploy, Git, and different set of tools. Similarly, we have a advanced networking specialty certification that would test your networking skills that could be deployed on the cloud. The implementation of VPC, virtual private cloud, the public cloud, and the private cloud, you could set up different networking utilities over there. You got a big data specialty certification specifically for domain of big data, such as MongoDB, Hadoop, such kind of technologies you're dealing with on the cloud. Similarly, if you are a field from ethical hacking or security, be it network or system security or application security, you should be better having a grip over the dedicated services on Amazon related to certification security, like guard duty and prevention against DOS attack, DDoS attack, and various kinds of attacks. The person who are dealing with this security application, they could pursue the certification for security specialty. You don't need to complete all kinds of certifications, but when you complete all the certifications, you are a cloud guru or a full professional of Amazon Web Service. Having an AWS certification would guarantee you and as well as your industry employer that you are a professional over the cloud and you could do anything with the cloud, not just Amazon Web Services, but you could also handle various applications or Microsoft Azure, Google Cloud Platform, IBM Bluemix, Salesforce, Heroku, and more. Just the name differs of services and simple things. The concept remains the same over every cloud application. So moving next to the cloud practitioner, let us learn a few things about cloud practitioner. It will provide you the basic level of understanding of overall tools. Like here, you have to learn about the various storage options like S3, Simple Storage Service, the EC2, Elastic Compute Cloud, the IAM roles that you are going to assign. You have to create your account, test your Simple skills, and simply, Amazon actually offers you a 12-month free tier for practicing and learning about different services for free. To a certain extent, you could use a certain section or certain compute level of different services. And you can take advantage of this thing if you're practicing for a cloud practitioner. You could test the skill for 12 months, give a practitioner exam, and after you have tried these services, you would be easily comfortable with this practitioner exam. After you are done with practitioner, you could decide in which domain you are going to move ahead. When you have decided your domain, you could move further with any other certification. It will cover the basic concepts. You don't need to be expert over each service or any set of service, but the basic services that are very important or vital for any kind of cloud applications at the beginner level. Then we have a cloud architect for associate and professional level. For the associate level, we have to validate the ability of effectively demonstrating the knowledge of architects for secure deployment of different applications that would be fault tolerant, cost efficient, scalable, and distributed over AWS. Don't think that AWS only counts for the technical skills. You have to be evaluated on the managerial skills as well. Because on cloud, there are various applications and various kind of operations. Suppose you need a 1 GB RAM for any kind of application, but you accidentally created 2 GB RAM. So it will be a wastage of money as well as time. Because your company has a limited capacity of capital, resource, and different things, they won't be willing to pay a cost higher than it could be done with a cheaper price. You have to also evaluate or minimize the cost and maximize the product. So you would be managing those things as well in architect. With the solution architect, you would be an overall developer on Amazon Cloud. You are going to plan things, how your enterprise application would be implemented over the cloud, how your traditional on-premise data could be transferred on the cloud and application could be deployed. You would be a leader or a planner. So the architect is an experienced job. You have to be experienced practitioner at first, then you could apply for this architect examination. Then there is an examination for developer, which will validate the technical knowledge for different applications. You would be evaluated in deploying, developing like services on API Gateway, AWS Lambda for serverless application, mobile applications, and different kind of applications. You also need any in-depth knowledge of at least one high-level programming language as well. You need to be proficient in C, Java, Python, Ruby, and any kind of application or programming language on a higher level. So you would be a developer on the cloud. And you would also be working on distributed applications, operating systems, and things like that. If you apply for professional, it will evaluate a more skill set, not just on the cloud, but on the programming and developer domain as well. You could be asked for server administrator, OS processes, and different set of things. Then we have operation administration or SysOp administrators that are system administrators that could automate and repeat deployment of applications. So you would be well and good in domains of containerization, virtual machines, and different sets of repositories, Git, project management tools, and different things. You have to be a better develop a better understanding and implement a various set of things. You could create different developers with different roles, testers, and you are going to manage the project from there. You would be having an examination for associate and professional level. The professional level would be hard enough and are technical for provisioning, operating, and different distributed applications that you would going to handle. And associate with would be not much difficult as compared to professional. Then there are specialties examination for big data. Those who are the organization who require a big data personality or individual that could handle a big data applications. Like if you're going to apply for a YouTube developer, you would maybe requiring this thing. However, YouTube is not implemented on Amazon. It is implemented on Google Cloud, but a big data expert would be required for different set of jobs. Similarly, for networking and different things, organizations that deal with on-premise as well as cloud applications, they need a specialist on this networking domain. So you would be having a better grip over networking as well as cloud platforms, and you could implement such things. If you're up to this, for example, if you have applied for CCNA, Cisco Certified Network Associate examination or Juniper examinations, and you are willing to move to the cloud or advance your career, you could pursue this thing, AWS Certified Network, Advanced Networking Specialty. Similarly, if you're a person with a security, a cyber security and such things in mind, and you have given the Certified Ethical Hacker examination like CEH, you could also pursue this certified security specialty on the Amazon Cloud if you're pursuing job in this field. So this was about various kind of certifications on Amazon Cloud that you could pursue in your career. We are going to learn more in detail in the coming lectures. Till then, keep moving and keep learning and keep moving ahead. Hi there. Welcome to this lecture, and here we are going to learn about AWS Cloud Practitioner. So let's start. As we all know that AWS Cloud Practitioner is the foundational course or certification that you need to give and prepare for that thing. If you want to be a cloud architect, a DevOps engineer, or any specialty based designation you want to associate yourself with, you need to start your journey with Cloud Practitioner on your path to become an associate or professional AWS accredited professional. So let's start. AWS Cloud Practitioner is a certification exam coded as CLF C01, which is a basic examination for individuals who have knowledge and skills necessary enough to demonstrate the overall understanding of AWS Cloud. The overall understanding conveys a meaning that you have a basic knowledge of each and every services under different categories. In the analysis category, in the machine learning, in DevOps, in compute, in the storage, database, identity and access management, mobile application, and more. You can omit certain special features like VR, AR, and such things, but the overall basic thing that are required for any cloud applications that could be used in simple as well as complex scenarios, you must be aware of those things, not in depth, but in the basic level. You have to demonstrate your understanding of the AWS cloud. You would be able to create a storage device. You can upload different files, provide those things for web development. You could host a website, simple website, run test applications on Android devices, iPhones, and different things. You could be able to create a different virtual environment or different developer tools for repository management, project management, and such things. You would be able to create IAM roles and more things. Don't be confused. We will be learning about those things. So there are various options. We have the solution architect, the associate developer, system operations, which will be studying a specific technical roles addressed by different certifications. You are not going to learn these things if you are pursuing for the practitioner exam. You have the basic knowledge. The practitioner exam would validate an examiner's ability to define different parameters. You would be able to define what AWS cloud and the basic global infrastructure, be it platform as a service, infrastructure as a service, software as a service, database as a service, and different things. You would be able to define various architectural principles, how you would be defining your different architecture, your enterprise application, and such things. You would be able to implement different services on AWS platform and use their common use cases. You have a basic security and compliance aspect of AWS platform and share a different security model. You should be able to define the billing, account management, and the pricing model. You could optimize the pricing, reduce the utility factor, upgrade as your demand, and minimize the cost, maximize the output. You have to identify different sources of documentation, like technical assistance, such as white papers and support tickets. You could raise support tickets in case of any trouble, and AWS team would be available there to support your scenario. You could be able to describe basic core characters, deploying and operating on the cloud. Then the examination part for AWS cloud practitioner would consist of two categories, a multiple choice and multiple response. There are two types of questions in the examinations, and the multiple choice will have only one correct response and three incorrect responses. There will be in total four options. It will be multiple choice based. You have to select any one option which will be correct. And the multiple response has two correct responses out of five options. You have to select two correct responses from the given five options. You have to select one or more responses that best compete with the statement, and you have to answer those things. Unanswered questions would be scored as incorrect. There is no penalty for guessing. So you can guess mark. There is no negative marking. And you will be having an unscored content where are items that are not is code, just to gather statistical information that in which topic you are proficient or such things. They are not evaluated and it does not affect your score. Then this examination is fail or pass examination. So you need to pass in order to get the certification. There is no certificate of participation like of thing. You have to take the exam. You have to score the minimum passing score. The exam would be of 1000 marks and the minimum passing score is 700. So you have to score 70% marks in order to get the AWS certification. Your score will show you how you performed in the examination as a whole and whether you have passed or not. If you have explored the AWS services and tried deploying simple instances and learn those things at the basic level, you would definitely score a high number with the passing examination, passing marks on the AWS cloud practitioner examinations. You don't need to worry if you have given time to AWS applications. If you can spend more than 2 hours in a day, then you can learn those things in a 2 or 3 month period. If you can devote less time per day or per week, you have to give more time in order to get the desired skills. Or you could simply go through the questions or sample questions available on the net. You don't need to prepare very hard for this examination. You don't need to worry. The exam score will contain a table of classifications for your performance at each section. The information is designed to provide general feedback concerning your examination performance. So it will reflect everything and you will be given a certification. So here we should go with the syllabus part. Here the syllabus is divided into four categories: the cloud concept, security, technology, billing, and pricing. Each consists of different weightage. The cloud concept would consist of 28% of questions. Security would consist of 24%. Technology would consist of 36%. And billing and pricing would consist of 12%. The services that you are using would be covered in the technology and cloud concept. The security would be evaluated based on your IAM roles and different identity and access management tools. And billing and pricing would optimize your skill over this thing. So with the cloud concept, you must be able to define different concepts of AWS cloud and its value proposition. Then you need to identify different aspects of cloud economics and list different cloud architecture design principles like platform as a service, software as a service, infrastructure as a service, and how you could leverage those things, the private cloud, public cloud, and such things. And in the security section, you would be able to define different AWS shared responsibility model. The shared responsibility model is not very difficult thing. It was simple that in the cloud, the Amazon will provide you the software, the resources, and infrastructure. And you as a developer or a client would be providing data to this thing. You share the responsibility for securing your data from your side, and the Amazon would be Amazon team, and their involvement would have the responsibility of securing the software and the data center. So it is a shared responsibility model. Then it has a cloud security model with the compliance concept, how it is implemented, how you can integrate those things. Then we have identity and access management, the IAM role, how you can define and create. Then there will be resources for security support and reporting like CloudWatch and logs, whatever you could monitor, the CloudTrail and different things. Then we have the technology section where we will be able to define models for deploying and operating on AWS cloud. We will be deploying different applications like S3, storage, compute with EC2, Elastic Compute Cloud, and more things. Then we will be able to define AWS global infrastructure, the core AWS services that are part of most of the applications and resultant solutions. Then we have the resources for technological support like question raising, the ticket raising, and the documentation and different part that you get. Then the fourth and final section is billing and pricing. You would be able to compare and contrast various pricing model for AWS based on resource utility, time utilization. You would be able to recognize and optimize different things related to AWS billing and pricing. Then you have the identify a resource available for billing support. You have to issue this billing concept, then you would be well and good to take this examination and gain a certification if you pass. And don't worry if you don't pass in the first attempt or the second attempt or the third attempt. You have number of attempts to take in order to achieve the certification. If you fail first time, you can give it second time. If you fail second time, you could give third time till whenever you want until you pass. So there is do not need to hesitate or fear. You simply need to give some time. Hi, welcome back, friends. We are learning about AWS certification, and here in this lecture, we're going to learn about a specialty certificate and security. So let's start. As we all know, there is a certification roadmap for cloud certifications. The beginner certification is cloud practitioner, and we need to have this certification in order to move further in the upward level, be it associate or professional level. There are certain specialty certifications, be it network, big data, or security. The security is a specialty certification which proves your skills over the security concerns, and you would be able to implement a secure and manageable operations on the cloud. So you must be aware of each and every services that are there on the cloud, be it database, compute, storage, mobile, or different applications, and you have a better edge over the security. So it is intended for individuals who perform a security role, be it cyber security, ethical hacking, a white hat hacker, or such things. You need to have an understanding of specialized data classifications and AWS data protection mechanism. You have a better understanding of data encryption methods and mechanisms to implement them. You have an understanding of secure internet protocols like HTTPS, SSL, and more. And you have a better grip over implementing them. You have a working knowledge with hands-on experience in different AWS security services like Cloud HSM, Guard Duty, Artifact, Certificate Manager, and more features of services to provide a secure production environment. You have a competency gained from 2 or more years of production deployment experience with AWS security services and features. You have the ability to make a trade-off decision with regard to cost, security, deployment complexity with a set of application requirements. You have an understanding of security operations as well as risk. And if you are currently a certified ethical hacker or a different kind of thing, you would be well and good enough in implementing cloud security as well. The examination would consist of 2 sections, multiple choice question and multiple response options. In the multiple choice, you have only 1 correct response with respect to 4 options. And in multiple response option, you have 2 correct responses out of 5 options. So we have to select, and there is no penalty for guessing. We have different underscores content as well. It is similar to the cloud practitioner exam, with a difference with minimum passing score is 750 or 75%, which may change over time as per the criteria decided by Amazon. So let us move with the syllabus part. With the cloud security specialty, we have 5 different domains or sections divided for on which we have to be evaluated. First is incident response that have 12% weightage in the examination. Then there comes a logging monitoring, which would cover the CloudWatch, CloudTrail, billing and different kind of things for having a 20% weightage. Then there is infrastructure security, which has the highest weightage of 26% in the examination compared to other sections. Then we have identity and access management, which would have a 20% of weightage. That is vital to create different roles, have different permissions for different designation of people, for developers, testers, and any user of our project work. Then there is a data protection section that consists of 22% marks. Together they make 100%, and each section is equally important, and we need to score in each of the sections. The incident response would cover different topics. We have to have if we have an abuse notice, we have to evaluate those things. We have to evaluate the suspected compromised instance or exposed access key. We have to prevent exposure of the access keys and find the suspected instances, and we need to fix it. Have a better credentials, a setup, and secure. We need to verify that the incident response plan includes our relevant AWS services or not. If it does not involve relevant services, we have to add the relevant service. Then we need to evaluate the configuration of automated alerting. We can set up alarms on CloudWatch and more things that we can do. We can execute possible remediation of security related incidents and emerging issues that we can go through. Then there is a second section that is with the logging and monitoring. We would be able to design and implement security monitoring and alerting as well. We need to troubleshoot a security alert and security mechanism that we want to implement. The troubleshooting may not be very tedious for us. We may automate these tasks in a secure fashion. Then we'll be able to design and implement the logging solutions and troubleshoot different solutions as well. Then there comes the infrastructure security section where we will need to design the edge security on AWS. We will be writing it on the architectural plane as well, adding the security gateways, the storage gateways, API gateways, with added firewall, the guard duty, or different kinds of things that would increase our service. We need to incorporate a different identity and access management services in different layers of our application between client server or any kind of emergency. In case of VPC, we need to implement more security concerns. We need to design and implement secure network infrastructure as well, because networking is the key to hacking. And if you fail your network's security, your entire system may crash. Then you need to have a troubleshooting of a network security infrastructure, and securing this thing would be very useful. In case of any error or failure, you would be able to troubleshoot, point out the reason of error, and try to fix it. Then you need to design and implement host-based security implementation. Then we have identity and access management. We would be able to implement a scalable authorization and authentication system in order to access different resources on the cloud. We only need to provide access to a person in which of his domain. We don't need to provide him all the root accesses. A root access would allow him to read, write, and execute simultaneously on all the files and features, and we don't want any user, silly users, to access such thing. If a client is only a visitor, we would not be interested in showing him the server-side script or the confidential files. We can manage those things. Then we have a troubleshoot for authorization and authentication system by going to the IAM management console. We can fix those things. We have a data protection section where we'll be designing and implementing key management issues and use. We would be having a key management systems for public, private key, and encryption keys that are going to be implemented across our systems. We will be able to design and implement data encryption solution for data at rest and data in transit for all kinds of things like streaming data, storage data, a data kept in a database. We need to encrypt and provide different things like SHA or RS1. The encryption protocol are used in relational databases, and we need to incorporate such things. AES, DES, and different encryption protocols could be used there. So this was about a security specialty certification of AWS Cloud. When we have enough knowledge of underlying technologies, tools, and being familiar with such things, we would be able to achieve the certification whenever we need. A certification is just an authentication or proof of work. But just you need skills in order to perform certain tasks. We focused on gaining skills. Having an experience would be better than having a marks or certification. So stay focused on the security mechanisms, because the system needs to be secure enough. It will be secure when you spend time understanding what is there. Having an integrated and all-rounder approach in different things would help you out in that scenario. Keep building your own solution. Till then, keep learning and keep moving ahead. Welcome, friend. Now we are going to learn about AWS identity and security in the coming series, which consists of various AWS services on cloud, including Artifact and more tools. So these are the identity and security tools or services available on AWS cloud, using which you could secure your everything cloud instances, be it from mobile services or web services, Elastic Beanstalk or EC2 instances, S3 storage, or things like that. We have Artifact, a Certificate Manager, Cloud HSM, our Directory Service, a Guard Duty Inspector, a Secrets Manager, a Single Sign-On, or WAF and Shield. We have these services at our hand, and we could use these services to secure our applications on the cloud. So these are the things. We have IAM that we already know, the Identity and Access Management, that is the most vital tool for each AWS instances. If you're creating a group or project with code commit, you need an IAM role. You need IAM role for a wide range of services like in DynamoDB, AWS Lambda, and things like that. It will authenticate various users where you could create your identity and different kind of roles. Similarly, there are various services that go hand in hand for same authentication, authorization, and security perspective. So let's start with AWS Artifact, which is a no-cost self-service portal for on-demand access to AWS compliance reports. Here you have access to the reports that you could create on-demand for self-service for analyzing various perspectives of your services that are running there. You can generate a central resource for compliance-related information that matters to you. Artifact provides you on-demand access to security and compliance reports and select online agreements with AWS. The reports available on Artifact include your service organization control reports, payment card industry reports, and certifications from accreditation bodies across geographies and compliance verticals that validate the implementation and operating effectiveness of AWS security controls. Agreements available on Artifact includes a business associate addendum and a non-disclosure agreement, the NDA. You have the Artifact directly from the management console. There you can view different kinds of reports or documents. It provides a customer with easier access to obtain different reports as well, based on different kinds of government or regulatory authorities of integrations and regulations. There are a few benefits of Artifact. It provides you a comprehensive resource on different auditors, the issued reports, the certifications, accreditations, and other third-party attestations that you need for your publication of your instance or applications or projects on the cloud. You have the agreement governance to review, accept, and manage your agreements with AWS. You can apply your AWS agreements to current and future accounts with your organizations. So you could be in a safe state, be it a NDA, non-disclosure agreement, and things like that. You could create those agreements or sign up on the existing agreements anytime you want. Then you have deep insights to perform diligence of AWS and enhance this transparency for security and controlled environment. You can monitor and secure the appliances with AWS with immediate access to new reports. There are different reports out there which have been tested by auditors or third parties for compliance of global, regional, and industry-specific security standards that you need to follow for deployment of certain instances or certain projects. So it is very simple to build in a report on AWS artifact when you move to the security and identity category on Amazon Cloud. You have this artifact service, and from this artifact, you could create or generate the report. Moving to the report section, you can generate the artifact of particular things like cloud computing compliance control catalog, C5. You could get this artifact by hitting the get this artifact option. You will download a certain format of documents on your system. You can go through the document and think, include the things, implementations. You can get AWS Certificate Manager certificates with Elastic Beanstalk. You can add different domain names for review on the SSL and TLSL certificates. Or artifact repositories to build and upload on the sections. You have the artifact repository, the EC2 environment. You can build and upload the Jenkins with the artifact using the simple XML type syntax. Then you have the EC2, the production server, staging and test server that you could select version and deploy on the test servers. The artifact service is in the format of either the JSON or the XML format, where you have the key value pair of details. You could define the version, the statement, effect, allow or deny, the action, and the get artifact, the resources, and the ARN for Amazon resource name for respective artifacts, and things like that, that you could attach with different services. You have different stages of development for the source code to build and staging. And there you have the artifact roles for the documentations and things like that in the DevOps or software development lifecycle. Here, when you are trying to build certain project using the DevOps on cloud, you have the Git repository, the GitHub or code commit. You could write the code, perform various operations like webhook on API gateway, making a get or post request, allowing it to integrate with a Lambda scripts using code build and artifacts role to integrate these services or add a report to authorization of the bucket or different things. So this was a brief introduction about the artifact. We can get our artifact. It is not a difficult thing, but there are a huge number of artifacts out there, and you have to choose for proper licensing, and you may need a legal person for different stages. We'll be learning more security and identity services on Amazon Cloud. Till then, keep learning and keep moving ahead.
Welcome friends, here in this video we are going to create an instance for Amazon Artifact, which is a security identity and compliance tool. We are learning the AWS security and various services. So this is Artifact, which features a comprehensive list of access control documents, ACDs, relevant to compliance and security on Amazon Cloud. You can build get various certificates like BioForm, IT control, implementation responsibilities, cloud computing compliance, global financial regulatory principles, and more. You can get various kinds of artifacts and integrate it with various services on Amazon Cloud. You also have services available in multiple languages based on the different countries like Japanese, the service organization controls, SOC reports, and more. You have various kinds of agreements here for different countries, and you can choose from the organizations. You must first download this agreement, instantiate it, and you will load various artifacts. You have NDA, a non-disclosure agreement based on these artifacts. You could choose to print and accept and download option here.
So it could be downloaded and you could go through this artifact based on your scenario.
Welcome back, friends. We are learning identity and security on Amazon Cloud. And now we are going to learn about the Certificate Manager, which is a service on Amazon Cloud or AWS in this lecture. So let's start. Certificate Manager is among the different services available as an identity and security tools for authorizations, authentication, and securing your cloud instances or projects out there on the cloud. So with Certificate Manager, which is a service that lets you easily provision, manage, and deploy public or private SSL certificates or TLS certificates, be it a secure socket layer or transport layer security certificate for use on AWS services with your internal connected resources with web or mobile applications. And the SSL certificates are used to secure our network communication and establish identity of websites over the internet, as well as a resource on private networks. With Certificate Manager, you can remove the time-consuming manual process of purchasing, uploading, and renewing SSL TLS certificates. So all these things will be automated, and you have to define the domains or different things like that. It could be integrated with the request of a certificate. Deploy with ACM integrated AWS resources such as load balancers, CloudFront distributions, the APIs on API Gateway. With Certificate Manager, you can handle certificate renewals and enable you to create a private certificate for your internal resource management and different life cycles centrally. You have these things, and you have to pay for monthly operations for private CA and for the private certificates you issue. And for other public resources, you have to only pay for the resource cost, not for the public CA's certificates. There are some benefits for using the Certificate Manager. You have a free public certificate for ACM integrated services. If you integrate different services on the public domain, you have the free access for TLS or SSL certificates, and you have to only pay for the underlying resources being made by, implemented by load balancing or API gateway or things like Elastic Beanstalk or Lambda. Then you have the managed certificate renewal option, which will be managed by Amazon Cloud using the ACM for the renewal process. They automatically don't need to go on the manual basis, be it on-premise resources or on the cloud. You get certificates easily by error-prone steps or to get a website or applications. There is no need to generate a key pair or certificate signing request, a CSR, or submit to certificate authority or upload install a certificate once received. There are a few clicks available on AWS console, where you can request a trusted SSL certificate, so it will be easy for you to manage these things. It will be a lot of cost saving and time saving. There are various use cases with Certificate Manager. You can protect and secure a website. If you have a website or web applications out there, or the mobile applications, you would have an access to secure this thing by adding different encryptions for sensitive data so that no phishing or similar hacking technology could be implemented against your website, so that your website would be capable in serving your customers in a more secured fashion. So it will allow the identities of website over the internet to encrypt the communication in between and encrypt all the sensitive data in transit for authentication. You may be a banking solution or a big private firm or anything, any organization who is very concerned about their security or their web applications. You need SSL for that thing. You have to protect and secure your internal resources. Then you can also use a Certificate Manager For private certifications within your organization on the cloud or on the premise, you could use these things even in the VPC, virtual private cloud. The private certificates could be used for identifying and securing communication between different connected devices, be it in a VPC, virtual private network, or servers, IoT devices with IP camera and different tools like that, Raspberry Pi and things like that. You could generate different private ACMs, AWS certificate managers, and enter a private certificate programmatically using the APIs or things like that. You can help meet compliance requirement with SSL and TLS to meet a regulatory and compliance requirement for encryption of data in transit to keep it more secure. And you have the improved uptime so that the website may load faster than the earlier one, and you don't need to worry about the expiring certificate. So this is a dashboard for AWS Certificate Manager, where you can easily provision and manage and deploy and renew the TLS certificates anytime you want. You can simply request a certificate and create a custom or default certificates, providing a different ACM request. You have to choose a certificate for the ACM, upload a certificate to IAM. You have the option to choose a certificate from IAM and more options. You have to configure security settings. You have to configure load balancers. You have to configure security groups. You have to configure routing. You have to configure register targets with security certificate manager. Then you can generate a certificate based on your account. With TLS or SSL, this is the difference between a normal website and a secure website with SSL. A normal website may start with HTTP, Hypertext Transfer Protocol, and a secure website with SSL and TLS will have a domain like HTTPS, the secured, with a lock symbol. So it will be secured and verified. It will be registered. So your website may look like this if you have a TLS or SSL certificate added to your domain. Then you can add a private certificate authority. This will be a flow. You could have the EC2 instances or other resources like devices, on-premise servers, or things like that. All these could be managed with a private certificate manager on Amazon Cloud. You could select your different certificates, choose from the existing certificate, choose an existing certificate for identity and access management, upload a new SSL certificate, or have move forward. You can generate multiple certificates based on different projects or applications. Here is the workflow. You are a developer or in a team of developers. You could create a different instances or other resources like S3, EC2, Lambda, Mobile Hub, or things like that. Then you could generate a certificate manager request, generate an ACM certificate, Amazon certificate manager. You can integrate these things with the CloudFront, the resources with ACM, and implement on different locations or regions throughout the globe. It could be integrated on on-premise, the VPC, and Amazon Cloud as well in any region. You could add a load balancer with a VPC or in the normal cloud. You have custom resources and things like that. So this was about the certificate manager. We're going to learn more about identity and security on cloud. Till then, keep learning and keep moving ahead.
Welcome back, friends. Here in this video, we're going to create an instance for Amazon Certificate Manager, which is available as a service under the security, identity, and compliance options on the Amazon dashboard. Here you can create an instance for Certificate Manager by going through the dashboard options. So as it says, ACM, Certificate Manager, makes it easy to provision, manage, deploy, and renew SSL Secure Socket Layer TLS certificates on AWS platform. So you can provision various certificates, the SSL and TLSL certificates, and you can create a private certificate authority as well for you and your IT administration team to enable a secure managed infrastructure for issuing and revoking private digital certificates. You can get started with both the options from the Get Started option available here. So it is a documentation for ACM. You can get an overview. If you have any doubt and you want to check any updates, you can go through the documents. All the recent updates are being published here and the complete detail here. Then here it is an option. We can import a certificate. We can request a certificate. To request a certificate, we have to provide a authority. You can choose from the private certificate body or the Amazon body. Go through the any option. You have to provide the certificate body. You can request a public certificate. If you have public certificate, you have to provide a domain name based on your organization. For example, say www.abcdwxyz.com or thing like that, .co.japan. You are issuing a SSL certificate for a specific website. You can choose for the DNS validation or email validation, which could be validated for you in either of the mechanism. In the first case, you can obtain permissions to modify DNS configurations, and in the second case, you won't have permission. For email, you have to provide the email ID associated with your account. And when you are done here, you can confirm and request the option. The authority type could be a subordinate CA here currently. You have to provide the details of the organization. Say anything. What is the name of your organization, the unit of the organization, the country where it is residing, the state and province, and more like that. The common name, the locality name. So you can create an SSL certification and make your website more secure. It will be available to your users in a secure fashion. Phishing could be quite difficult if you opt in an SSL certificate. You can provide various options, the common name for your, and hit the next option. You can always choose from the advanced settings that is available here. You can choose from the RSS certifications, the ECDSA, or more, and the algorithms that are used to generate the key. You can also enable the certificate revocation list, CRLs, to your S3 bucket. You can provide a link to your certain S3 bucket related to this list. You can provide a custom CRL as well. And then finally, if you are done, hit the create and confirm option.
Welcome back, friends. We are learning identity and security on Amazon Cloud. And here in this lecture, we are going to learn about Cloud HSM, which is a service offered by Amazon Web Services for hardware security module. So let's start. It is among a service for identity and security with artifact, certificate manager, guard duty, single sign-in, and more. So with a Cloud HSM, which is a hardware security module, you can secure your hardware in utility with your own encryption keys on Amazon Cloud. You can manage your own encryption keys with FIPS 142 level 3 validated HSMs. You have Java cryptographic extensions, a Microsoft CryptoNG, and different libraries available to you with industry standard APIs. The Cloud HSM, which is a standard compliant and enables you to export all of your keys to most other commercial available HSMs, subject to your configurations. You can have a fully managed service which automates time-consuming administrative tasks for you, such as hardware provisioning, software patching, high availability, and backups. You have quick scaling availability and the capability to remove different capacities on demand with no cost. There are huge benefits with Cloud HSM. You can generate and use encryption keys. You have the control of your encryption keys. You can deploy secure compliant workloads. You have load balancing and high availability options. You can use an open HSM built on industry standards, and it is easy to manage. So how it works, you have a cloud services instance running on Amazon Web Services, be it on a virtual private cloud or a public cloud. You have a cloud HSM running as an instance within a VPC on AWS. You can add an SSL authentication to your application by an HTML HSM client. Suppose a client makes a request for a website, it will pass through the cloud HSM, reflected back to your dashboard, and authenticated by the SSL on the application and HSM level. It runs your Amazon VPC, enabling you to easily use your HSM application running with Elastic Compute Cloud or EC2 instances. You can add a standard to your VPC security controls to manage different data centers on cloud. You have different things, separations based on roles and things like that. There are various implementations or use cases of HSM. You have the offload SSL processing for web services. For secure socket layer SSL authentication, you can use to confirm the identity and web server to add an HTTPS connection via the certificate manager and other tools. You have the protection of with private keys for an issuing certificate authority using public key infrastructure or PKI for entity to issue digital certificates. For your organization to store your private key and sign the certificate request so that you can securely act as an issuing certificate authority to issue certificates to your organizations. You have to enable transparent data encryption for Oracle databases. You can use Cloud HSM to store different types of encrypted data. It could be supported with SQL Server, RDS, and different kinds of databases as well. So this is a example with using cloud HSM with a VPC. Here we have instance of HSM connected by SSL to different VPC instances. Here we have one application instance running similarly. We can have different instances running simultaneously in sync with each other. There will be on an authentication stage for hardware security module. That will be authenticated via the cryptographic keys to the client. We have different kinds of certificates for hardware as well. The hardware certifications, the manufacturer hardware certification, HSM certification for clusters, and cluster CSR. We could also integrate HSM with different applications or cloud vendors as well, like Appian, SAP, and different tools like that. We could also integrate with VMware Cloud. We have the Cloud HSM where we have a person to have the control keys and crypto operations. Then there's an AWS administrator which manages the appliances and different DevOps tools. We could also integrate it with our different kinds of network instances or services with subnets, resource groups, and different things. It will protect you from a malicious invader for compromised front-end instance. It will protect you on the hardware level or for the database level with certificates and things like that. We have bucket. We can add the security to your bucket by allowing you to create backups authenticated with HSM, or you can restore to the new with HSM. You can perform these operations both graphically and with a CLI command line interface of Amazon command line. So this was an introduction about cloud HSM, which is a quite a complex topic. When you dive in deeper, you have different kind of security layers that you could implement for the hardware and the application level of security. We'll be learning more on security and identity management. Till then, keep learning and keep moving ahead.
Welcome back, friends. Now we are going to create an instance for Amazon Cloud HSM, which is a security and identification tool available on Amazon Cloud. You can create an instance by going through the dashboard. Here you can create clusters, delete clusters, create backup routines, and more. You can configure a cluster based on certain virtual private cloud. You have to define the cloud. If you don't have a VPC instance yet, you can create. You have to provide a location region, and you can create a cluster. So here it is, the cluster is being created. The creation process is undergone. When it is created, you can perform various operations here. You have a backup option available. You can perform addition of nodes and more operations, and when it is not in use, you can delete it anytime.
Welcome back, friends. We are learning identity and security on Amazon Cloud, and here in this lecture we're going to learn about directory service on Amazon Cloud. So that it is among us different services on the cloud for security and different tools. With directory service, you can manage Microsoft Active Directory on the AWS cloud, allowing you to enable the directory aware workloads and AWS resources to use managed Active Directories with the cloud. You have a managed Microsoft Active Directories, which is built on actual Active Directory on your system and does not require you to synchronize or replicate data from your existing Active Directory to the cloud. You can use standard Active Directory administrator tools and take advantage of built-in Active Directory features such as group policy, single sign-on with Microsoft AD. You can easily join EC2, RDS, or SQL Server instances to your domain and use AWS Enterprise IT applications such as Workspace with AD users and groups. You can get started with Amazon Active Directory for free or for the pay as you go. You have three options to choose from when you create an instance for AD. You have the simple AD Active Directory, you have the Microsoft AD, then you have the AD connector to connect different ADs. There are some benefits for this thing. You have easily migrated directory aware on-premise workloads. You can easily migrate Active Directory dependent applications securely on different workloads with AWS Cloud. You have the managed Microsoft AD. You can use the group policies to manage EC2 instances and run AD independent applications with cloud without need to deploy your own AD infrastructure. You have easily extended existing domains like Chime, Workspaces, Management Consoles, and other AWS resources. You have to use actual Microsoft Active Directory using group policy objects and different features like fine-grained password policies, Kerberos-based sign-on, and so on. You get all these services right there on Amazon. You have centrally managed application access on devices with AWS. You have a shared single directory for cloud workloads with different RDS, EC2, SQL Server, or such applications. You have simplified administration with managed services for data replication in different availability zones, monitoring and detect error handling things. So how it works? First of all, you have to create AWS directory service where you can create a managed directory quickly. Then you can deploy or migrate your new applications. Then you can enable AWS ecosystems with RDS, EC2, SQL, Lambda, Workspace, Single Sign-On, and more. Then you can manage access to different users, groups, and roles to manage access to your directory-aware workloads and AWS services. And later on, you can connect with different appliances or exist with a new active directory with Directory Connect. There are certain use cases with this. You have to use Active Directory Group Policy Object, GPOs. You have high-availability Active Directory in the AWS cloud. You have the single sign-on with Active Directory credentials. You have seamless domain join EC2 instance from multiple accounts and VPCs. There are certain use cases with working examples. Suppose we have a VPC virtual private cloud rightly deployed on our AWS region, connected with a different region. We have a directory owner account and a directory consumer account. We can associate different kind of things using VPC peering and directory sharing with a directory owner account and directory consumer account. Both have AWS managed AD Active Directory. The owner have the managed account and the consumer has the shared AWS managed account. So you can share your domain, share your files, utilities with different instances on the cloud. Similarly, we have different things here. Scenario, we have a DNS request, which is initiated from inside the VPC for simple AD, where configuration instances for on-premise DNS domain name system could be used. We can have on-premise DNS resolver to request for on-premise resources. Then the request get faced with VPC resources that are not cached up. So it will be sent back for the AWS AD DNS, which could be sent back for the Route 53 if it is matched for a certain domain. You can create an instance for Microsoft AD, Simple AD, or AD Connector easily on the Amazon Directory service by hitting the Create Simple AD, Create a Microsoft AD, and other options. Then you have to provide the directory details and review the settings to create a directory. You have to provide directory DNS, a NetBIOS name, administrative passwords, and description, and various kind of VPC details, subnets, and other things like that. After you have provided these details and configured, you can hit to create that thing. Similarly, we can have a AD connector federation, which could be assigned with IAM roles to connect different AD users for read-only admin or S3 access. You have a write-only access permission, read and write permissions, root permissions, and different kind of access permissions. You could also set permissions like along different roles for different AWS services, like S3, Lambda, API Gateway, or things like that. Then you have AD users login via access URL for SSL login authentication. On AD credentials, then you have LDAP and Kerberos request proxied over the VPN. So this was a simple scenario where we have an availability zone, a resource, a Microsoft AD distributed over different availability zones. We have installed Elapsed binaries by using EC2 instance run command. We can have the web server instance running there and the AD management instance running out there. We have the management console dot MSI account and connected these things. We can install LDIFA schema changes directly on the AWS Microsoft AD. Then Active Directory directory service could be integrated with AWS Lambda, a CloudWatch event, which will be monitored back. We can handle these things with Workspace and bring an integrated solution with combining different AWS services. We have the public subnet, the different network groups connected with the Active Directory, either for having a public subnet or the private subnets, different availability zones. So this was about the directory service on the Amazon Cloud. We can implement the secure environment or things like that easily on the cloud. You don't need to migrate your instances from or to the AWS cloud. You can handle these things the way they are being managed right away. We are going to learn more about security and identity management. Till then, keep learning and keep moving ahead.
Welcome back, friends. Here in this lecture, we are going to create an instance for Amazon Directory Services, which is available as a tool in the security, identity, and compliance on Amazon dashboard. So you can create a service by simply going through that link. So here is our dashboard for directory service. We have multiple directory being created here. We can set up new directories, delete old directories, and perform various operations. On the left-hand side, we have various operations like Active Directory. Here we have directory shared with me. We can perform various actions like reset passwords and more. We can fetch directory details by clicking the directories. We have the ARN related with it, a related service that is enabled like Amazon Workspace, a QuickSight, and more. It has a certain VPC link to it, the subnets or directory. Similarly, going through the another directory that I have created, it is also enabled with a Workspace. It may have an URL that is optional based on other service that is being integrated with it. Then we have options with cloud directory. We can delete this directory anytime. We can also create schemas similar as a database. We want to create a directory, you have to select the directory type like AWS managed Microsoft AD, simple Amazon directory, the Amazon directory connector, Cognito user pools, and more. You can go with any of these options based on your requirement. If I go with the Cognito pool, I have to define the Cognito instance as well. Define the triggers and more. Let's choose any of them. You can go with the standard edition or the enterprise edition. The enterprise edition would be a costlier option to you. You have to provide a DNS name for your website, the NetBIOS name that is optional, and more options. It is hosted with Amazon. Then we have the simple AD, which has RDS and more services associated with it, DynamoDB, AWS Lambda, and more. We have administrator password. We have to provide the passwords and more. Then we have the AD connector. When we will create, it will simply ask us the small and large options and hit the description panel. When we choose the Cognito user pool, it will redirect us to the Cognito dashboard user console, from where we can manage the Cognito services, and simply we can integrate with Cognito tools.
Welcome back, friend. We are learning AWS Identity and Security. And here in this lecture, we're going to learn about Guard Duty, which is another security utility on Amazon Cloud. So let's start. Guard Duty is among various services of security with Artifact, Certificate Manager, Cloud HSM, Directory Service, Single Sign-On, Secrets Manager, WAF and Shield, Inspector, and more. So let's start. Guard Duty is an intelligent threat detection and continuous monitoring tool to protect your AWS account and different workloads that you're deploying over different regions, availability regions, or other kinds of VPC environment. You can secure your instance safely with Guard Duty. It is a cloud scale threat detection technique which you could use. You can monitor for activities such as unusual API calls or potentially unauthorized deployments that indicate a possible account of compromise or security compromise that you could detect and choose to bat. In a simple personal computer, you have a block list where you could block different IP address or different websites to be loaded on your system or to connect your system. Similarly, you could perform various kinds of preventions or block different domains, obviously, and IP addresses. Along with that, Guard Duty guarantees you to with protection for denial of service attack or distributed denial of service attack, DDoS and DoS attacks. It is one of the most costly service on Amazon Cloud. Because it provides you a very secure fashion, it has a wide range of products that is being used to keep you secure. It can analyze billions of events across your accounts for sign of risk. And it uses intelligence technique, machine learning to detect anomalies in your account and different kinds of CloudWatch events. It can monitor different things and you could be just sit back and relax. So how Guard Duty works? With a few clicks in the console monitor, you can create a Guard Duty instance, add to your account, and then you can start your continuous analysis work. And then you can intelligently detect the threats, which could be third-party threats, the security compromisation, DoS attack, and more. It could be prevented, and you could take actions, be it either a Lambda trigger or things like that. You can also move to the dashboard directly and perform various operations from there, or you could run your custom scripts that can be triggered with the Lambda. There are huge benefits of using Guard Duty. It is an intelligent threat detection system, so you don't need to hire a person or a developer or a security analyst solely for your system. In case you hire a person, he or she may take some time or compromisation could be occurred. You could hire a person along with this Guard Duty. With the Guard Duty, which runs 24/7 throughout the globe, you can be secure. It has a centralized threat detection across the different accounts. So you don't need to customize it multiple times for multiple accounts. You can, many organizations that use multiple AWS accounts can be centralized for proper cost allocation, agility, and security. You can customize these things on AWS. It strengthens your security throughout the automation. It uses machine learning, tags, security groups, resource details, and different kind of techniques to keep your domain or stuff safe out there on the cloud. There are various related services with Guard Duty. You have Amazon Mashi. This is a machine learning powered security service to discover, classify, and protect sensitive data. Then you have CloudTrail to track and automatically respond to the account activity. Then you have Amazon Virtual Private Cloud Flow Logs and AWS Shield. The Guard Duty could be used for brute force attack, drop point attack, Tor communications, the API failures, and different kind of things. You can secure it anytime you want. This is a dashboard for GuardDuty when you will try to create an instance from the Amazon account. This page will pop on your screen. From here, you can hit the Get Started button and create a GuardDuty instance. There could be various use cases with GuardDuty. One of those is here. We have a CloudTrail instance running out there. We have VPC flow logs, DNS flow logs that could be monitored by the GuardDuty. And GuardDuty will generate certain reports or the findings, which could be fetched from the CloudWatch events also. And the CloudWatch event collector would collect those things, generate certain Lambda functions based on CloudFormation templates. And those Lambda functions will perform actions from the GuardDuty side. With the GuardDuty trends and the remediations that you could use anytime you want. Similarly, you can have more use cases with GuardDuty. You may have different accounts using GuardDuty that could be connected with CloudWatch events associated with different Lambda functions, and that could be deployed easily. You may have a centralized or decentralized model implemented out there anytime you want. Then there could be different things like that. When the CloudWatch event generates a call, say in 6 days and week or more like that, and a system manager parameter store encrypts a third party access key, then we have a threat detection analysis from the site. We can download it, upload it to the Lambda. And from the Lambda, we could move our details, the complete CSV file into the S3. And that could be analyzed based on the authentication module of the IAM using the GuardDuty. GuardDuty can generate reports, analyze your stuff, raise a Lambda trigger, or perform a certain task that you predefined it or allow it. Then it could be also integrated with Amazon SNS, Simple Notification Service, or WAF, or the VPC control, DynamoDB, or more. The core could be Lambda. Lambda would be very useful in these scenarios to generate a trigger or simple scripts. We have responding to findings, immediate remediation, to compromised instance, the remediate compromised AWS credentials. We have automatic remediation for GuardDuty, CloudWatch event, Lambda, and things like that. So this was about GuardDuty. We learned certain things about GuardDuty, and we can implement these things. It is not a free tier service. So when you create an instance for GuardDuty, you will be paid. You will be charged. So be careful. If you really need this thing, you could go for this. Or if you have a funds, for learning purpose, you could also go for that. Otherwise, it will be very useful when it comes to server deployment or securing of your business intelligence software or complex applications out there on the web. So we're going to learn more security tools in the coming lectures. Till then, keep learning and keep moving ahead.
Now we are going to create an instance for Amazon GuardDuty, which is a tool available under the Security, Identity, and Compliance category on Amazon Cloud. You can create its instance by going through the option and hit the GuardDuty button. It may take some time to load this service. You can use GuardDuty to as a threat detection system to manage your workload. It will block all the unauthorized IPs and different things. You can analyze the CloudTrail logs, DNS queries log to generate security findings, and more. You can hit this enable GuardDuty option and link any URL available.
Hello and welcome back, friend. Now we are going to learn about Amazon Inspector in this lecture. Which is an identity and security tool for assessment of your cloud instances. So let's start. Amazon Inspector is an automated security enhancement service to help you improve the security and compliance of applications deployed on AWS cloud. It could be compared with few other services, security services, be it Config Rules and Trusted Advisor. All three are security in the cloud based on the customer. This is the role of the customer to provide security in the cloud. But for the security of the cloud, there is the role of AWS compliance and their AWS team themselves. With Inspector, you can secure the insights into your application, drive the security insights that are relevant for your applications. With Config Rules, you can create rules that govern the configuration of your resources. And with Trusted Advisor, it will give you advices for best practices for performance, reliability, and security. You can use Inspector in a combination of these two services. It is basically used for vulnerability assessment as a service, built from the ground up of the DevSecOps. It is an automatable via APIs. It integrates the CI and CD tools. On-demand pricing model is being implemented. It is static and dynamic rules packages. It generates the findings, which we could analyze and perform various operations. Amazon Inspector automatically assesses applications that are deployed over the cloud for vulnerabilities or deviations from the best practices. After performing an assessment, Amazon Inspector produces a detailed list of security findings prioritized by level of severity. These findings can be used as a part of detailed assessment report that you could use for driving a knowledge base of hundreds of rules that could be mapped for best practices for security of your software versions that could be vulnerable. You could remove those things that are causing threat to your system. There are huge benefits of using Amazon Inspector. You can identify application security issues. You can integrate security into DevOps. You can get certificates easily. You can leverage AWS security expertise. You can get streamlined security compliance. You have the enforcer security standard for different appliances and instances. There are various customers that are using Amazon Inspector and be benefited by using these things. They could be benefited in terms of cost, money, time, and everything like that. This is a dashboard for Amazon Inspector. When you create an instance, this will be the introduction page from where you could get started. You can install, run, and serve these things. Here is a sample report of Amazon Inspector, which it will display the findings of potential security issues discovered after an assessment run on a specific assessment target. It grades a severity level from high, medium, low, or informational. The findings could be instances for the vulnerability. The target could be web servers or things like that, and the templates. You could check whether what are the severity levels, and based on the severity level, you could perform various actions based on your priority. You get three options where you have to first install the AWS agent on your EC2 instances. Then you have to run your assessment for your assessment target. Then you have to analyze, review all your findings and remediate security issues. You have to install AWS agent on EC2, run assessment for the Amazon Inspector and review the findings and so on. There could be best practices for AWS, or there could be demos. And you have to shift whether the Amazon production of total passed or failed. You could monitor these things in a dashboard environment with graphs and various metrics being displayed to you. You can integrate this with a wide range of services. Still here, say here is a use case for Amazon Inspector, working with other instances as well. When a CloudWatch schedule or a CloudWatch event occurred, it may trigger a Lambda for the EC2 or other kind of instances, which could be integrated with an inspector, SNS, or Lambda. RKX to create an SES email service or more. The assessment would kill the instances that are malicious after an inspection would be done. Simply, it could be integrated with other services as well, with parameter store, SNS, CloudWatch, EC2, Lambda, GuardDuty, and more. So this was a brief introduction about AWS Inspector. We would be learning more tools of the security and identity in the coming lectures. Till then, keep learning and keep moving ahead.
Now we are going to create an instance for Amazon Inspector, which is a service available under the Security, Identity, and Compliance. We can integrate this service with a wide range of Amazon services. So here it is, the inspector, which enables you to analyze the behavior of your AWS resources and help you identify potential security issues. You can install it as an agent with your EC2 instance, Elastic Cloud Compute Cloud, and run these services based on a weekly, monthly, or daily basis. You can also choose from running once. It will perform the assessment and check for vulnerabilities in the software and host the hardening benchmarks and implement the best services, best practices in the configuration category. It will find any error. The GuardDuty is finding error. The inspector will create an analysis report on that. It will perform the assessment. And based on that assessment, you can define the templates. You have to provide the rules, the set of rules, and provide a duration amount for which it is being executed.
Welcome back, friends. Here in this lecture, we are going to learn about Secrets Manager. Keep your secrets or sensitive information like database passwords or certain kind of credentials or anything like that. It is a security and identity service on AWS Cloud. You could keep information in a secured fashion. So let's start. When you have different instances running out there and you have sensitive information such as credentials or passwords, database username or such things, or simple thing, your personal secrets, you could keep it in the cloud. When you fear that you may forget those secret or confidential information, here it will be protected in a cryptographic manner using different kinds of algorithms and such things. It will be secure. You can easily rotate, manage, and retrieve credentials, API keys, or other secrets through the life cycles. It will allow you to keep certain secrets. You can, that could be built-in integration for IDS, for MySQL, PostgreSQL, and Amazon Aurora. These are the databases which could be easily integrated with the Secrets Manager. This service is extensible to other types of secrets also, with API keys, authentication tokens, and more. You can also use fine-grained permissions and audit secret rotation centrally for resources in the AWS cloud with third-party services or on-premise. There are various key features offered with the Secret Manager. You have safe rotation of secrets, you have built-in integrations, extensible with Lambda, you have on-demand or automatic rotation with versioning, you have fine-grained access policies, you have encrypted storage, you have logging and monitoring tools available on your end. These are the benefits. You have secure audits. You also have the pay-as-you-go option here. So this is simple to create a secret. You may be a person who has a personal database, having certain kinds of a custom app or a different code for connection, string, and different things. You could encrypt those things with a secret manager. It will be keeping the protected secret text that could be used throughout your process application runtime. This is the way when you create an instance for a secret manager on AWS Cloud. Three options will appear on your screen: credentials for RDS database, whether you want to create for RDS or for other databases or any other type of secrets, including API key. You have to provide the username, the password, and the encryption key methods, the KMS, KMS that is used for key management system, and the formats of data. Suppose you have a secret name like this, and you have a description. You can move to the next step and define the rotation and then review the settings. Here you have a customer and an application server having the API client user. You could store the secrets on the secret manager, which could be controlled by the admin via the secret service. The secrets manager will authenticate these secrets with the key management system and reflect back to the AWS API client. It is simple. You have to request the current password. It will request to the database. Database will generate the requested data and the response from the secret manager to the custom app. The secrets manager, we can store the parameter store. We have the instances, the key, KMS, encrypt and decrypt keys. We can store those things. We have the customer master key, the encrypted key. We have the metadata, we have the version data. You can encrypt a secret value here with your customer key and the encrypted data key that could be referred as a public and private key of a person. With Secrets Manager, you could keep secrets of EC2 instances as well, the various credentials for different tasks. So this was a simple thing. A secret manager, it could be using it throughout your instances. It is not a very complicated thing, but easy, simple, and reliable thing. We will be learning more about the different security and identity tools. Till then, keep learning and keep moving ahead.
Now we are going to create an instance for Amazon Secrets Manager, where you can write or provide this secrets or any kind of credential information or confidential information, which you can store in the encrypted fashion. It could be anything like a password, a username, or an associated directory configurations, the API keys, and database credentials, and more. You can create its instance from going through the dashboard. And you have all the details. Then you can create a store a new secret button to store a secret type. You have to choose from the tab. It could be a database secret. You have to, that could be a credential based or anything like that. Or simply you can write your custom type of secret in a plain text or key value pair. Just writing a plain text. We have a key value pair here, ABC123, the key and the value. You have to choose the encryption key. You have to provide the name of the secret. What is the name of the secret? Say it could be a username for my email ID or anything like that. Actually, it is not recommended to store your password anywhere, but in case you need it could be lengthy, you could not memorize it, you have to store it anywhere. You can configure the automatic rotation. You can choose to enable or disable automatic rotation. If you choose enable automatic rotation, you have to provide the number of days, the interval, or custom option on which it could be integrated. You have to provide the Lambda function associated with this in case you have, or you can choose for the disable. After you have defined all the things, you have to you have this option for sample code. It will generate a sample code for your key, the JavaScript, Java, C Sharp, Ruby, and Python code are available here. When you are done, you can hit the store button and it will be stored. Here is our secret key, the alpha. It contains every information that we have initialized. Similarly, go through the settings. You can find the settings, the ARN, associated ARN, the Amazon resource name for this this instance. You have all the configurations here available and more. You can always create multiple kind of secrets and store various secrets of various confidential information with a secrets manager. You can perform various options. You can edit the configuration encryption key. You can find the decryption key as well, edit it. You can schedule the deletion based on certain days. You have to provide a value. You can delete if anything is not required. It won't cost you much amount, so don't worry about the payment.
Welcome back, friends. Here in this lecture, we're going to learn about single sign-on or SSO on Amazon Cloud, which is an identity and security service. So let's start. With a single sign-on, you can centrally manage different access to multiple AWS accounts and business applications. You may be having an application deployed using a website, an Android and iOS app. You can centrally manage authentications, and you have to log in using a single account. So what is it? Suppose we have an SSO account associated with different websites, and there's an admin account added to SSO. So we need to sign in only a single time. And when we log in with that account, it will be reflected back to other applications or websites at the same time. It makes it easy to centrally manage access to multiple AWS accounts and business applications. With just a few clicks, you can enable a high availability SSO without the upfront investment and ongoing maintenance cost for operating your own infrastructure. So you can easily manage those things. You can add user permissions to all your account in AWS organizations centrally, and you can also include the built-in SAML integrations to many business applications such as Salesforce, Box, Office 365, and more. You can configure wizards, you can create security assertion markup language integration, and extend SSO access to any of your SAML enabled applications. You can use these things for corporate credentials and other things. Before SSO, your things like in this way, you have to provide authentication for the same application running on different machines. But after SSO, when you log into your single machine, it will be reflected back to other machines running the same applications. There are huge benefits for using SSO. You have the centrally managed access to your AWS account. You can manage these things. If you're a developer or an administrator, it will be of huge, huge benefit to you. You can, it is easy to use, no technical details, not very tough. So it is easy to learn and easy to use with just few clicks. You can create users in SSO or connect by to existing directories very easily. It has access accounts and applications from one place. You can handle these things like Box, Salesforce, and Office 365 applications or different BI tools. So how it works? You have to first enable the AWS SSO in the AWS Management Console. Then you have to connect your corporate identities, be it Active Directory or AWS Directory Service. Then you have to grant SSO access to your account and applications. Then you have to manage your permissions centrally. You could do these things very easily. There are various customers benefited from SSO. be it startups or technical giants. They could build it for their SaaS solutions, software as a service, or different kind of things. There are built-in support for AWS accounts and business applications like Dropbox, Slack, Office 365, G Suite of Google, Box, and other things. And of course, all the services of AWS. Then there we have identity as a service solutions for AWS that could be used with a single sign-on. It simplifies the identity management and access control over corporate information for all your digital business domains. While maintaining a secure environment, you can simplify identity and access management. You have to provide a single sign-on. You can quickly deploy with or without AWS account as well. It could be integrated with a wide range of services. It has an elastic SSO team. They could be working on different projects or different vendors. The Amazon partner network is huge. Then there could be various use cases for SSO. One of them, it could be here, is a typical use case where there's an AWS console having development and production environments running on the cloud, where you could manage permissions to AWS account, permissions, SSO access to various business cloud applications like 365, Dropbox, Slack, and you can also manage custom SAML access, and you could also add on-premise AD Active Directory via the AD connector or AD Trust using Microsoft Active Directory on AWS Cloud. There could be also different use cases as well, which could be using with Amazon Cognito for authentication with third-party tools like Facebook, Yahoo, Google, and more. You could also use those things for mobile app development or web development. You could also be integrated with that. You can also integrate it with a LDAP identity store and SSO endpoints with the browser interface and things like that. So this was a brief introduction about Amazon SSO, single sign-on. We can integrate SSO with a wide range of applications to build flexibility and provide your customers or users a better grip and user interface. We will be learning different identity tools. Till then, keep learning and keep moving ahead.
Now we are going to create an instance for Amazon SSO, single sign-on, which is a security tool available from Amazon dashboard. You can choose this option and create an instance for SSO, single sign-on. It is a cloud service that makes it easy to manage access over multiple AWS accounts and business applications. You can set up SSO, assign SSO access to users and groups in your corporate Microsoft Active Directory, or you can use with accounts and business applications. There are various use cases available for this. You have to enable SSO at first, then you have to connect with your corporate identities, and then you can integrate with other tools. Here it has various easy integration and commonly used business applications associated with a single sign-on like Zoho, Zendesk, and more. You have to hit the enable AWS SSO opt button available here. If you do not have the support, you have to create an with organization. You will find the organization details. You can also go through the docs, documentation, and read the getting started guide to learn how you can perform that thing. Actually, a few services are there that is not available on multiple countries. You have to set all features to be enabled. And AWS organization account, master account is a must. Before you begin with SSO, you have to define various tools. If you should have a existing Microsoft Active Directory. Currently, I don't have. If you have an Active Directory, then you could integrate it with a AWS Directory Service and then choose with a SSO single sign-on. It will allow you to access both the Active Directory on Microsoft and the AWS Directory together. These are the steps you have to perform them with Management Console and create the master account credentials, create an Active Directory on Microsoft or with Amazon Directory, and then you have to create the SSO and integrate it with all of them. It is not a difficult thing, simply done.
Welcome back, friends. Here in this lecture, we're going to learn about WAF and Shield, which are services available on AWS Cloud under the Identity and Security category. So let's start. AWS WAF and AWS Shield are the services that are being a part of physical and technical security of your cloud instances running out there. With WAF, you get the layer 7 application protection for web traffic filtering with custom rules. You have malicious request blocking. You get active monitoring and tuning a service at your hand. These rules could be flexible, pre-configured protection, and advanced security automation. You can add partner rules with WAF. It is a web application firewall at the application layer that lets you monitor different HTTP and HTTPS requests that are forwarded to Amazon CloudFront or application load balancers. WAF also lets you control access to your content based on the conditions that you specify, such as the IP address that originate from different query strings at CloudFront or load balancers. You could send content by a 403 HTTP status code that could be forbidden. You could configure CloudFront to return a customer error page when it is blocked. You can choose from one of the behaviors, allow all requests except the ones that you specify. You could also choose to block all requests except the ones that you specify. You could count the requests that match the properties that you specify. You could use these kind three categories or three kinds of things for different purposes based on your requirement. WAF allows you to protect your web applications or server from different kinds of malicious bots, distributed denial of service attack, DDoS attacks, or legitimate traffic like ping of death attack from the spammers, from hackers, and malicious things. It will be a very secure end for your server. It could differentiate between attacker and a good user till a certain extent for bypassing the data from the CloudFront to a website. It will be an added security layer. WAF has several benefits. You can define conditions for web requests, such as based on IP address or request origination, the country, the value in request headers, the strings, the presence of SQL code. You can allow, block, or count web requests that meet the specific conditions. You could also check for a period, like a 5-minute period. You can add rules that you can reuse for multiple applications. You could get real-time metrics and sample web requests. And you can obviously administer these things using the WAF API. With the Shield, AWS Shield, you can use WAF to get access control list or ACS to help minimize the effect of DOS attacks or DDoS attacks. For additional protection, you have the Shield with a standard Shield and an advanced Shield. The standard Shield is automatically included at no extra cost when you are part of WAF. And with the advanced protection option, you get expanded DDoS attack protection for your EC2 instances, load balancers, a CloudFront distribution, and Route 53 hosted zones. AWS Shield advances the additional charges. For more information, you could always refer to the docs. With the AWS Firewall Manager, you get a different set of services or maintenance resources on the cloud. The supported regions at the current level for AWS Shield and AWS is US East, West, EU, Asia Pacific, Tokyo, in the West, California, and Frankfurt, Sydney. These regions are supported currently, and in later period, it will be supported in more other regions. With the AWS Shield Advanced Protection, you get a valid user and attacker distributor, and you automatically get mapped with the application load balancer. Obviously, it will cost you a much higher amount. The WAF and Shield Protection could be created directly from the dashboard. You could create a WAF account, a Shield, Advanced Shield, or a Firewall Manager, which may simplify your administration and maintenance across multiple accounts. You could go to DAS options and create your protection environment. You can create a web ACS, a rules, cross-site scripting conditions, a geo match, IP addresses, size constraints, SQL injection preventions, strings, and regular expression matchings. You could create those things to protect your applications, be it mobile, web, or IoT applications. You could define a protocol policy, allowed HTTP methods like get, head, put, post, pass, delete options, and more. You could add the catch HTTP methods based on a different whitelist or blacklist. You could define different rules, the conditions that would prevent different kinds of bad requests being made from a hacker, attacker, a bot, or things like that. So it will be very useful there. The infrastructure security pattern could be implemented with a WAF Shield in different locations. It could be managed with the ELB, Elastic Load Balancer, in different VPC or native cloud. It could be integrated with CDNs, Content Delivery Networks, as well. With the AWS Shield on the Route 53 and the CloudFront map with a WAF, you get a better security of both the domain as well as your server. You could add AWS partner rules, or with the Fortinet, you could get these things, FortiWebs. You could also prevent your system with DNS query floods for a few good actors biased by thousands of bad bots. You could remove those bad bots or distributed denial of service attacks. Then you have different cases. You may have a detector, a robots.txt exception list, or different things. And your bad bot blocker could be integrated with a custom scripts on AWS Lambda that may trigger based on certain rules that you provide with the WAF and Shield. So this was a introduction about the WAF and Shield on the AWS cloud. You could implement the protection of your web or mobile applications very easily. It is not a difficult thing. Try building your own solution. Until then, keep learning and keep moving ahead.
Now we are going to create an instance for Amazon WAF and Shield, which is a security identity and compliance tool available on Amazon Cloud. You can choose this option from the services options. It will help you protect the AWS resources from web exploits and basically DOS attack and DDoS attacks, distributed denial of service attacks that are ping of death, and different hacking attacks that could harm your traffic and the server. You can initiate that thing. Typically, you have a website or apps that are running over serving a customer base of millions or thousands of customers. And when there is an attack kind of DDoS, there you have a malicious request to your site so that it could crash down or actual users won't be able to access your site. You have to provide these identities. Here you have to set up the access control lists, a list of access control list. You can define rules that contains conditions. You can provide various IP or malicious IPs that are there. You can choose to remove the bots. You won't want any kind of such traffic to occur. You create this instance. You have to provide a web ACL name, any name, and the CloudWatch metric associated with the region. Then you can create the conditions, the cross-site script matching XSS attack that could be used. You have to prevent that thing. You can choose the geo match conditions, the IP match conditions, SQL injection mechanisms. There are more options for security implementations, but using the WFN shield would ensure you more security over anything like that. It is cloud, so you need a better protection mechanism and a more advanced thing. You have an option, so you have to leverage this thing. It could be a costly, after you have defined everything that you have to set up, you have to go through the review option. Here we have the firewall manager as well, the application firewall, the physical firewall, network firewall. Here we have the shield. You can go through the monetization option. What services are covered in which option? The DDoS responsible team support and more. The free tier is free, activated, and the paid option is not activated now for Micron. It will charge a heavy amount, $3,000 per month. If you have an organization, you could use. There is no pay-as-you-go option because it will be running every time. Your traffic may come up or down. It could be scaled, but the security application could not be scaled. So you have to pay the upfront cost. If you have the capability, you could use. Here you can manage various things. String regular expression matching and all kind of security implementations.